Hello, and welcome to the TI Precision Lab series on protecting ADCs from electrical overstress. The goal of this series is to cover methods for protecting an ADC-based system with external components. Furthermore, this series will quantify the impact that the protection components have on performance and how to minimize this impact. This video starts with an introduction of electrical overstress, or EOS, and electrostatic discharge, also known as ESD. We will look at the differences between EOS and ESD, as well as potential sources of EOS. We will also show the different internal ESD structures used in data converters and give a brief description of their operation and limitations. First, let's compare ESD and EOS. ESD, or electrostatic discharge, is the sudden flow or discharge of static charge between two oppositely charged objects. ESD is a very short event, typically in the range of nanoseconds. The voltage magnitude of an ESD event can be quite high in the range of kilovolts, and the pulses can have very fast edges. ESD damage can occur in circuit and/or out of circuit. EOS, or electrical overstress, happens when a voltage is applied that exceeds the absolute maximum rating of the device. Compared to ESD events, an EOS event can have a much longer duration. It may be milliseconds, seconds, or even a continuously applied overstress voltage, and the voltage level is typically lower than that of an ESD event. In fact, it may be just over the absolute maximum rating of the device. For example, applying 10 volts to a device with an absolute maximum rating of 7 volts will cause EOS damage. Here we will cover some common types of faults that can create an EOS condition. One possible fault is a harsh electrical environment. For example, motors and generators can create strong electromagnetic fields that can have an inductive kickback that generates large fault voltages. For systems with high voltage supplies, it may be possible under some circumstances for a low voltage device to be inadvertently connected to the high voltage supply. For example, an amplifier with a 15 volt supply connected to a 5 volt data converter has the potential to create an overvoltage event. This series will cover these types of circuits in detail. Some devices can be damaged if the power supply initialization sequence is not followed according to the datasheet. Plugging a printed circuit board into a powered socket is called hot swapping. This has the potential for electrical overstress, as transients can occur when the board edge connector makes contact with the electrical socket. A very common form of electrical overstress occurs when an amplifier or data converter input is powered before the supplies are powered. Another common electrical overstress problem is applying a negative input signal to a unipolar device. This can also happen when the input wires are reversed or miswired. A reverse power supply connection, such as connecting the positive and negative supplies backwards, can also occur as a result of miswiring. In addition to these common issues, there are many other ways to damage devices. The absolute maximum specifications in the datasheet are given to define the conditions that you can operate the device in without damaging it. This presentation will explain how to interpret the absolute maximum specifications and to provide circuit design techniques that will protect against EOS and ESD damage. Furthermore, we will focus on the impact that the protection circuits have on system performance, the ultimate goal being to protect the device from EOS and ESD while having minimal impact on performance. This slide shows the internal diagram for three different approaches to protect against ESD. The key point to emphasize is that these are inside the device and are designed to protect against out-of-circuit ESD events. In some cases, these internal ESD protection structures can be used to help protect against electrical overstress, but in general, external components will be required. The first and most common type of ESD structure are the internal input steering diodes. The input steering diodes will take ESD signals that are applied to the input and redirect them to the power supplies. Another type of input protection structure are back-to-back Zener diodes. This type of input structure will remain off when the input voltage is in the normal operating range and will turn on when the input signal approaches the absolute maximum ratings of the device. This type of input structure is especially useful when the input range of the device is wider than the power supply voltage. The last type of input ESD protection scheme is the SCR-based protection structure. Similar to the clamp input protection structure, the SCR input protection structure will trigger at a certain voltage level to direct the ESD pulse to ground. However, unlike the clamp input protection structure, the SCR input protection structure will remain in a trigger to low impedance state until power has been cycled on the device. As a reminder, the SCR input protection structure is most often used when the input voltage range is greater than the power supply. This slide is just a short introduction to these input protection structures, and later on in this presentation we will provide a much more detailed description of these circuits, their operating characteristics, and how these structures can be used with external components to protect against overstress. This slide gives a little more detail on the SCR-based ESD protection structure. Strictly speaking, the details of the semiconductor operation of this device aren't critical for effective overstress protection in your system and are beyond the scope of this presentation. Here, we will provide a short simplified explanation of the SCR-based ESD protection structure's operation and some key details that are important to your system's overstress protection. A cross-section of the SCR structure and the equivalent schematic are shown here. It is called an SCR as it acts like a silicon-controlled rectifier and that once it is triggered, it goes into a low impedance state and will remain triggered until the power supplies are cycled. This structure can be triggered by overshoot or undershoot EOS signals applied to the input. Once it is triggered, it goes into a latch-up state and will remain in this state until the power supply is shut down. The IV curve shown at the right illustrates the operation of the SCR structure. First, its impedance remains relatively high as the voltage is increased across it. Notice that the current through the device is low for voltages applied from 0 volts to the threshold voltage, VT. Once the threshold voltage, VT, is exceeded, the SCR triggers and the impedance decreases significantly. This causes the voltage to snap back, or be limited. Increasing the voltage across the low impedance device will lead to very high currents. The purpose of this device is to protect the data converter from ESD damage during manufacturing and assembly, but it is not useful in protecting the finished product when it is powered up. Thus, if the data converter is powered up and this ESD structure is triggered, it will draw a large current from the supply and potentially damage the device. Furthermore, the triggered SCR structure will remain on until the power supplies are cycled on the device. As a result, it is very important when using devices with SCR-ESD structures to use external protection to assure that the internal ESD device never triggers. Later in this presentation, we will cover the use of an external TVS diode to prevent the triggering of the internal SCR structure. You might be wondering why we would ever use the SCR-type input protection structure. The main reason these protection structures are used is that they are well suited for applications where the input voltage range is greater than the power supply. You may remember that in the case of the traditional ESD diode, that the input voltage range is limited to the supply, plus a diode drop. For example, when using a traditional ESD diode, if the supply is 5 volts, then the input range is limited to 5.3 volts. This doesn't work for systems where the input range is 12 volts, but the supply is only 5 volts. Another reason the SCR structure is sometimes used is that the triggered on impedance is very low, so the holding voltage is also very low. Thus, the SCR input structure is very effective at protecting against ESD for out-of-circuit conditions. Nevertheless, when the device is powered, the structure can be a concern as you do not want to accidentally trigger it on when the power supplies are applied. This slide shows the details on two common ADC input structures, including the input protection and the sample and hold RC circuit. This information is normally found in the application section of the datasheet. The main difference between the two input protection structures is that in the case shown on the left, the ESD diodes are connected to the voltage reference, whereas for the case on the right, the diodes are connected to AVDD. The absolute maximum ratings for these inputs allow input swings to be 0.3 volts above the power supply or reference voltage and negative 0.3 volts below ground. As long as the input signal is restricted to the absolute max ratings of the device, the ESD diodes will not turn on over process and/or temperature variations. Another aspect to the absolute maximum ratings is limiting the input current to be less than plus minus 10 milliamps. This specification assumes that the ESD diodes are turned on and requires that the current is limited to less than 10 milliamps. It is generally accepted that if the absolute maximum voltage rating is exceeded by a few hundred millivolts, it is possible to avoid damage by limiting the current to be less than 10 milliamps. So for example, for a 5-volt power supply, applying 5.4 volts to the input would violate the absolute max voltage specification. In this case, if the input current is limited to be less than 10 milliamps, the device should not be damaged. Protecting the device by limiting the input current with an external diode is a common and simple approach for overstress protection, and we will discuss this in more detail later on. This slide shows how overdriving the ADC input can turn on the ESD diodes and impact the voltage reference. For this example, the voltage reference is 5 volts, so the absolute maximum of the input is set to be negative 0.3 volts to 5.3 volts to avoid turning on the ESD diodes. The input in this example swings from negative 0.8 volts to 4.06 volts, so the absolute maximum rating is not violated by the 4.06 volt positive swing, but is violated by the negative 0.8 volt negative swing. For the negative part of the signal beyond negative 0.3 volts, the ESD diode turns on and feeds through to the voltage reference. Notice that even after the overstress signal is removed, the voltage reference takes some time to recover. This kind of overstress signal should be avoided if possible, but in cases where it does happen, it is important to make sure that the input current is limited to be less than plus minus 10 milliamps to avoid damage to the device. One key point of this slide is to emphasize that the overstress signal will not just affect the ADC, but will also be fed through to the voltage reference. This slide illustrates the type of input protection commonly used on an ADC with an integrated analog front end, or AFE. In the case of this type of ADC, the supply voltage is typically 5 volts, but the input voltage range can be either plus minus 10 or 12 volts as well. Since the input voltage is larger than the supply voltage, it is not possible to use a simple ESD diode between the input and the power supply. For this type of product, there are two special ESD protection devices that will trigger at a specific voltage level. One type is the back-to-back Zener diode structure. This type of structure will turn on at approximately plus minus 15 volts and will limit the voltage to a constant level, similar to a Zener diode. When a transient fault voltage is applied to a Zener type input clamp, the fault voltage will be limited during the fault and operation will return to normal after the fault. On the other hand, when a fault voltage is applied to the SCR type ESD protection structure, the SCR clamp will turn on and remain triggered until the power supplies are cycled. For example, on the ADS8688, if a 25 volt fault signal is applied to the input for 1 millisecond, the input protection will trigger. This input protection circuit will remain triggered regardless of the input signal level until the power is cycled. Thus, SCR-type ESD protection is really only intended for out-of-circuit ESD protection, and it is important to avoid triggering this type of ESD protection when the device is powered. On the other hand, a triggered back-to-back Zener-type circuit will recover after the fault is removed without cycling the power supply, so this type of input protection can be used to protect against transient electrical overstress events. That concludes the theory part of the video series. Thank you for watching. Continue watching to try the quiz and check your understanding of this video's content. For the circuit shown below, what kind of internal ESD structure is not practical? The correct answer is A, input ESD steering diodes. These diodes are not practical for this circuit because the input voltage is 10 volts and the supply voltage is 5 volts. ESD diodes are only used when the input range is the same or less than the power supply. True or false? The internal ESD protection structures are designed primarily to protect the device during assembly and test. An example, out-of-circuit events. The correct answer is true. Internal ESD structures are mainly intended to protect the device during manufacture, assembly, and test of the device. This means that the ESD structure is designed to work without power applied. Which type of ESD structure will trigger on and remain on until the power is cycled? The correct answer is C. SCR-type ESD structure. As mentioned before, The built-in ESD protection is designed to work without power applied. When power is applied, triggering the device can create a latch-up situation. Which of the following does not apply to ESD? The correct answer is C, long duration event of milliseconds or more. In general, ESD events are very short, nanosecond type events with high voltages and fast edges. For the circuit below, what is the maximum input voltage? The correct answer is B, 5.3 volts. This is the reference voltage plus the internal diode drop. Note that the 0.3 volts for the diode drop assumes process variations over temperature.